Did you ever feel a little bit out of focus? Hello everybody and welcome to another episode of Stable Diffusion for Professional Creatives. Today we'll be taking a look at how we can play with focus by de-blurring or blurring pictures, and all by starting with Claude writing a couple of custom notes for us. We'll be taking a look at this workflow, which in reality is two different workflows. One part is the de-blurrer workflow and the other is the blurrer workflow, and we'll see how we can go from this picture to this picture, unblurring the background, and then back again from this picture to this picture by blurring everything that is not in focus, or from this picture to this picture, and back again from this to this, or from this to this, and back again from this to this. Same as always, you will be able to find this workflow in the description below, as well as any other custom nodes and models you might need. So what's the big idea behind all this? This workflow started from me missing a node that I thought could be useful in some of the things that I do, which is a node that could output a focus mask. Now, having been a fashion photographer for almost 10 years, I knew that even if the node wasn't there, or at least I couldn't find it, the technology to outline a focus map, or to even create a black and white map of everything that is in focus and everything that isn't, was there, was already achievable. If you think of focus peaking on the viewfinders of digital cameras or Photoshop's own tool to create focus maps, I thought, well, there must be a way to do the same with Python, and the main culprit here, I thought, was going to be OpenCV. Now, if you don't know about OpenCV, it's a Python library that contains a ton of tools for image manipulations that encompasses a ton of what Photoshop does, amongst a lot of other things. So being a pretty good photographer and a pretty bad developer, I thought about asking Claude to create a custom node that could handle what I was missing. And so I just asked it, hey, how do I extract a focus map from an image in Python? And there it is, our culprit in the first line, import CV2. And that's the command to import OpenCV. So, well, I was right. There was indeed a way to do all this with OpenCV. So there it is, Claude telling me there's some ways to do that, using Laplacian or Sobel, and creating a custom Python script that could handle the request. The only thing that was missing at that point was giving it context as to how a custom node for ComfyUI looked like, because this was just some Python script. It wouldn't execute inside of ComfyUI. So I gave it the structure for a custom node, and I got a custom node back, doing exactly that which I asked. So we see the node here, the init.py, and the requirements.txt file. I uploaded it on my GitHub and I began testing on RunPod. And after feeding Claude a couple of errors that I got, Claude corrected the mistakes. And after just two errors mostly, I got a working node. But what I got back wasn't this. It wasn't a mask that was all white for areas in focus and all black for areas that were out of focus. I got this instead, which is more of a line art outlining anything that is kind of in focus, using a sort of Z-map mechanism in order to give more weight to the areas that are more in focus and less weight to the areas that are less in focus. And so I call that focus outline. And while this has its uses, as we're going to see in a second, I wanted this, which is a focus mask. And so I asked Claude, right now the mask that it's outputting is a line art of sorts, whereas I wanted everything that is in focus to be white and everything that is out of focus to be black. And there we go. We got a modified version of the node that could handle the request that I made. But then again, I did find some uses for the line art. So I asked it to have both of them in the same node structure so I could call either one up for their own task. And so I said, can you add it to a previous node? I like it and use it, and I want to use both. So maybe call the previous one focus outline and call this one focus mask. And there we go, there's the final version with both nodes in it. And as we can see here, both live inside of my ComfyUI, one outlining the in-focus contours and the other outlining a map that is solid black for everything that is out of focus and solid white for everything that is in focus. Now, how do we use this? Let's start by the focus outline map. This map is very similar to a line art, but instead of having a fixed weight of black and white for everything that is a contour and everything that isn't, it's fading away from white to black the more distant it is from focus. And that's great, because I want to control the generation both with depth, and there we go, control net depth, and with line art in order to contain the borders of an image that, being out of focus, are not going to be as definite in the blurry areas. And so I decided to use this focus line art map as a driver for a control net line art as well. and there we see it. So instead of using a stock line art preprocessor, I am using the focus outline as a line art preprocessor. As for the focus mask result, which outputs everything that is in focus as white and everything that is out of focus as black, I am using the opposite of that mask, so I am inverting it, to drive the in-painting process. I want to in-paint over everything that is out of focus and keep the original image where it is in focus. And as you can see here, this is the mask that's driving the in-paint process. This is the generation with its result, and at the end here we have a sort of blending happening between the original image and the in-painted image, which right now is set to 1 on only the areas, once again, that are not in focus. And we also have a bit of a color transfer from the original image to the generated image by using the frequency separation and acting only on the low frequency layer. But if the result is a bit too much, what we can do is just lower the blending a bit, and there we go again. Now the result blends a bit more into the original picture. For this process, I am also using differential diffusion because it's an in-painting process and differential diffusion works wonders. When in painting, by assigning a different denoising strength to each pixel, depending on how close or how far they are from the border of the in-painting mask, and an IP adapter set on linear at half weight that takes the original image as reference. This whole process is driven by SDXL, but I don't see why you couldn't use also Flux fill, for example. And while this process has its uses, both in terms of direct uses, so to unblur pictures, and in indirect use cases, such as, for example, upscaling or adding details, let's face it, this was more of a challenge that I did myself in order to start from an hypothesis and then get into a result by building nodes that I didn't have access to, and just to overall check if something that I wanted to do could be done. I thought, well, an unblurrer is pretty cool, but since a lot of people are not going to understand its uses, might as well do the opposite as well, which looks cooler and it's way more used by people, which is a blurrer. And so by following the same kind of methodology, the same kind of structure, but the other way around, I built a blurrer as well. As you can see here, we are starting from the output from the first generation and then adding some depth of field. The structure is close to the same. You can see here in the apply contrast section that I'm using the depth, which is basically the same, and the result of the focus outline as the processed result that drives the line art control net, the inverted mask from the focus mask output in order to drive the in-painting process, but the image that I am in-painting on is not the original image, but it's the blend of a Gaussian blur of the starting image blended on top of the original image on every part that is not precisely in focus. But since this image is pretty bad, it's not exactly a great close-up photo, we need to go through a generative step in order to fix all of that, and that's the result. We can see here in another unblurrer example that by using both the depth and the subtle outline, the overall structure of the picture is overall well respected. Yes, it's adding details and there's a ton of artifacts going on, but the overall sense of the scene is well respected. And in the blurrer result as well, the same applies. The overall structure of the picture is maintained. There are, of course, cases in which this works better and worse. For example, in this case, the overall structure of the tree is well respected, but the complete lack of detail has to be superseded by what the model thinks should go, where those details are missing. But the overall placement of the decorations on the tree, for example, is not random. You can see this ball here or this ball here are perfectly placed where they should be, but just using the tiny amount of context it had from the blurred picture. One thing of note that happens in this picture, for example, is that the lights do not change. And that's because these LED lights that are out of focus for both the Sobel outline and the focus mask itself are in focus because they have well-defined edges, as we can see both here and here. And what is something in focus if not something that has a ton of contrast and a ton of well-defined edges between itself and its surroundings? So it's going to treat these LED lights, which are the bokeh result of having the tree out of focus, as something that is in focus. But even if the original picture is pretty chaotic and very out of focus, as long as it has some structure to it, the unblurrer can still work, as you can see here in this pine tree picture. And the blurred result is quite good as well. So all in all, apart from this being a tool that can be used or not, and I'm not really sure that it has a place in anyone's workflow, This was more a demonstration of how a concept in ComfyUI doesn't have to involve only the tools that are available to us. We can also think of a tool we would like to make for our own use cases, no matter however narrow that use case may be, and we can find a solution that can help us solve that use case. And well, in my case, with a ton of help from an LLM. And now pardon me while I definitely write the whole readme for these custom notes. I will definitely not ask Claude to do that for me. Hope you had some fun and learned something new. And I hope that this experiment gives you a tiny bit of boost to create something yours as well that is new and creative and can be applied to your own needs. If you like this video, leave a like and subscribe. My name is Andrea Baioni. You can find me on Instagram at reasonabushi or on the web at andreabaioni.com. And I guess I will be seeing you next time.